Computing is currently in a stage, in a polymorphic stage, where many different areas, computing emerging areas, are appearing in our lives. From cybersecurity, artificial intelligence, machine learning, quantum computing, Bitcoin, and other areas are impacting our society, our culture, our community. I am Cristian Servin. I'm an associate professor here at El Paso Community College. I teach the computer science courses and computing in general, including cybersecurity and intelligent computing. The reason why we create this series of program is to create awareness and educate the community and the society about the current emerging areas in computing. We are living in exciting days, an exciting society, where humans and technology we're living together. So the whole purpose of this episodes is to create the what and the how on this entire emerging computing areas. We will talk in particularly in these different areas of computing, starting from cybersecurity. That is the what. What is cybersecurity? What is information security? What is also the autonomous technology that is behind that autonomous cars, those cars that you see in the streets? What exactly is working behind those wheels? I know there's a human there, but in reality, it's a computer, a mechanism, an algorithm that is running the entire car effectively. Some other questions that have been emerging is social media. What is exactly happening in social media? What happens when you click a like or a share or a comment in Facebook, Twitter, you call it? So there's a couple of quick questions that you might have once you install some software in your mobile device. The only thing that we know is that you accept all the conditions as soon as you install that software or you create a new profile in that brand new software of mobile device. What is cryptocurrency, Bitcoin? Why is so many different considerations nowadays if we should switch to Bitcoin or we should invest to Bitcoin? What exactly is happening behind? Those are the questions on the what we're trying to achieve in this program. The how is the mechanisms, how that is possible. I teach computer science and I teach in my classes different algorithms about how to solve problems. Of course, not in the big impact that you see at this point, but are the fundamentals. And we will discuss that without going into the details, how you can do similar applications at home, of course, for educational purposes, and how can you apply them or create a mobile device when you can implement your idea. So let us start with an overview about what we will discuss through the series of this program. Again, the whole idea here is to provide awareness and education about what is exactly happening behind the scenes of that mobile device, about that website, about that interface, or about that platform that you use every single day from the very early morning to the very late night. So before we go further, let me just let you know, for those who are watching this, we're in 2021, we close to 2022. There's a lot of situations happening for the past year. We've been through a pandemic, we're trying to the recovery of the pandemic, and many situations have happened after the COVID-19 unfortunate situations. But in the meanwhile, we need to recognize what has been happening in the whole society, in the culture, and also what has been happening in technology, in computing. I don't know if you know, but close to 3.7 billion of humans are using the internet as we speak. So let me just tell you that there's a big difference between humans and non-humans. And I'm telling about that there's other mammals using this technology, but there's a lot of robots and intelligent computing that are using the internet. But I'm talking about humans. And I'm gonna talk about a little bit about how many humans actually they're using this technology. For example, humans create 2.5 quintillion data every day. Many people are worried about their plans or their cell phone plans that you don't exceed some kind of gigabyte. We're talking about quintillion usage of data per day that humans create. More than 63,000 searches every second have happened in Google processes. Every time you have a question, you go straight to Google or maybe other search engine, but Google is the most popular nowadays. You will be surprised that 63,000 searches happens every second. How about tweets? 456,000 tweets are posted on Twitter every minute. 46,740 images are posted onto Instagram every minute. How about YouTube videos? 4,160,600 videos are being watched on YouTube every minute. 90,000 Tinder swipes every minute. 16 million text messages happens every minute. 156 million emails are being sent. And there is 103,447,520 spam emails being received every minute. Obviously, there's a lot of information going on there. And everything has to be done through algorithms. All that mobile devices, everything that you see that you can contact with technology has an algorithm. For those who know, you might not know, an algorithm is a sequence of finite steps in order to solve a problem. Now, the problem is, it can be debatable, but in reality, if you have an objective, you can create everything with that algorithm. An algorithm will take everything that we have talked about it, all your social media, all your services, that information that you've been using, your Netflix accounts, your emails, all that information has been stored in one main point, and that will be used as the input for that algorithm. That algorithm will process all that information through your laptop, through your mobile device, through your tablet, and that information will be collected. And eventually we'll have a result. And the result, which is called the output, we might have different kind of an extraordinary solutions for you. I know, it seems to be that there is a lot of things there that you can see. Well, it seems to be that there's money there, there's some gifts, there's some other things. But in reality, what we have been doing through all this time is that we feed this algorithm. That algorithm will learn from our preferences, what we like, what kind of shows we like in Netflix and other items. And then we'll recommend some specific items for us. A little bit scary, but that is the truth. That is why there's an emerging computing area. Right now, there is data science or data analytics, including with intelligent computing that makes everything more effective and actually pretty effective, very, very, very scary, but very effective. And some people might be interested on that. But in reality, data analytics is just an intersection about computing and IT and information that you have right now in the hands, like your mobile devices, combined with some math, some statistic models, and then you put them together with one domain, business, information, sciences, all the different areas that you think it will have an impact, your information. And that intersection, everything that you see in the middle is called data science or data analytics. It's an extension of computer science or of computing. And it's one of the emerging areas right now that is taking control of most of the technology that we're using. Data science is just a combination of data mining, of course, data analytics, how to predict the future, of course. People might say, like, you cannot predict the future. Well, if you have enough data, then you can find patterns. Once you have those patterns, you can predict what's going to happen according to those patterns. The interesting thing is that we've been feeding those patterns for the past, I don't know, since you have your mobile device, you make the counts. I don't want to scare you, but that is true. You have seen that behavior when you order something online, and the recommendation, they're kind of okay, they're very close to what you would like to have. So that is what is happening right now in the emerging. And one of the areas that right now we're facing is facial recognition. Facial recognition has become very, very popular in technology nowadays because this facial recognition will recognize exactly the face characteristics that you have anywhere you are. Of course, you need a camera, but nowadays everybody has a camera. You can have a camera even in your car, at home, maybe in certain points. And that is being used in many different areas, including social media, in the ID verification, especially when you deploy security services and surveillance technologies. Face recognition is one of the most promising ideas in computing because that will protect a lot of people, of course, a lot of countries, a lot of actually entities and assets. But at the same time, it's a little bit concerning about the privacy and confidentiality that you have. It's one of the technologies that we're living right now. And of course, that shares a lot of information, including of your biometrics. And of course, there are some other situations that we need to pay attention when we use it. For example, privacy. Privacy right now, everything that is being used in technology has been stored in a server. What is a server? A server is basically a repository or a location in a computer. When you save, everyone has been saving all your information. Similar situation happens when you just log in into your social media. Everyone recognizes what is being there. What people are your friends? Who are the people who are not your friends? Or what you like in the news or what you don't like in your news? But that information has a level of privacy and confidentiality. That is very debatable, and nowadays we have to be aware about what is happening in this area of privacy, of course, cybersecurity. Cybersecurity is widely known because many individuals might have these ideas of access information. Of course, you need a piece of code, a piece of program, and nowadays there's many different programs in order to access information. Now, again, I just want you to realize that cybersecurity, it only helps you to be aware about the technology that is available for you out there so you can use to protect your assets. But also, just you need to realize that many people will think about what exactly is your assets and what exactly you are protecting and why. Social media is one of the emerging paradigms of concern, not because it's just fun or you just have this connection with some of your friends from high school, but also because that brings some kind of ethical considerations when you develop. One of the ideas here is big data, and many people talk about big data nowadays because everything that you actually do is being stored in information like the servers that you're talking about. And now you have a lot of ideas and a lot of data that people create in order for using clicks, like shares, tweets, or you call it. These ideas highlight different perspectives of humans. When you post something, you're basically there analyzing how you write. There are these algorithms analyze how you write, what kind of words you use, if you use more verbs, if you're actually you're using more more offensive, more aggressive, more pacific. Those are the ideas that are happening right now in artificial intelligence, machine learning, using social media. Of course, social media, you have the power of doing like, share, and subscribe. Maybe you have other items. The idea here is we need to be aware about how to use that technology wisely, especially because right now one tweet can have a lot of impact of a lot of people. Also, cyberbullying is one of the main dilemmas in social media. If you're using social media in order to basically attack some person, people will realize, and you know what? Social media services will notice that. I don't have to go very far away. Just watch the news, what's happening nowadays, and you will realize how controversial is this social media aspects. Algorithms are being designed for a purpose, and now they're trying to recognize patterns on those designs patterns. Also, when you like, when you share, when you have some kind of emojis, in order to express some kind of thought or feeling, they will realize what you like, what you dislike, and those are the things that they will bombard you with advertising and other concepts. One of the ideas that I like a lot nowadays is the autonomous car. Autonomous cars, they're very, very nice, very cool, very convenient, and very scary sometimes. And they're pretty safe, and I like to watch the news because every other week there appears some kind of news in autonomous vehicles, especially because they've been running there for a couple of years now, and that's how technology is being used, by testing them for a couple of years. Now we can see more events that is happening in technology using the autonomous cars. Now, when they design a car, of course, they design to make the car safe. Safe for who? That is the question. And there's a couple of dilemmas that we are actually studying nowadays about autonomous vehicles, especially these problems are not problems contemporary. They're problems that have been there, philosophically speaking, for a couple of decades now. And when I talk about safety, I'm not talking about safety in general. I'm talking about they were designed for the safety of who? I'm talking about the safety of the pedestrians, safety of the passenger, the one who's driving the car. Of course, who is the safety we're talking about? Those considerations come directly for the software developers, the software designers, who create that software, and when worst comes to worst, if there is some event, an unfortunate event, that we need to make a decision, who will be responsible to survive, or who will be the responsible to have the smallest amount of damage. One of the example is the trolley problem that is being, for many years now, is 1976, is being proposed by the philosopher Judith Jarvis Thompson. When you have a dilemma about if a car has the situation of an inevitable car accident that will cause an unavoidable harm, what will be the decision? Of course, that problem was a little bit pessimistic for many years. But if you think about it, nowadays with autonomous cars, we're facing the same situation. The only difference is that we don't make the decision, the software does that decision for us. This is a very important and very interesting problem nowadays that we would like to give a solution, a pragmatic solution, very far away from the status quo, which is difficult to solve. We haven't solved that problem for decades now. One of the interesting issues right now is learning machines, how these machines have been learning through time, through experiences, and what actually we've been doing. It's very general to talk about nowadays learning machines because all of us, we have a learning machine, a cell phone, a mobile device. Some of you have smart kitchens where you actually recognize that and you program at what time you're gonna be, your coffee is gonna be made, at what time you should open the microwave and prepare your dinner before you get home, or once you get home, it's already done and warm. This intelligence machines or intelligent devices, all often called Internet of Things, they're useful nowadays, and many people are using it every single day in their regular lives. The question is, what are we going to do with those, and who is storing that information? Now, let me just tell you something that we do here at EPCC. We actually have a couple of robots that we can actually play with them and tell you the fundamentals of how to construct a robot. The intelligence is what you develop as a software engineer, and you put it on top of that. The software, as you can see here, there is a couple of softwares that they can use in order to program these robots. And here we can see a couple of our students who are actually programming very small devices, and they can help us. Now, these devices are not expensive. You can get them from there. Actually, you can get Raspberry Pis, you can get Arduvinos, or you can get these robots that were pretty cheap, to be honest, online. So we're helping the community to construct these robots. And now we try to create more of them depending on the situation that we want to solve. Another feature, another emerging area is blockchain. And blockchain is emerging nowadays because of Bitcoin or other cryptocurrencies. Many people are moving to cryptocurrencies and invest in cryptocurrencies, but the technology behind the scenes is blockchain. This is a technology to help us to do integrity, to check that everything is being, a transaction has been performed constantly or continuously and consistently. So there's a lot of research right now in blockchain, and this is one of my favorite topics to discuss, especially because Bitcoin, everybody wants to invest in Bitcoin, but you need to be aware what is behind the scenes. Or you're interested, you can also do some mining. I'm not so sure how popular it is nowadays, but there's some consequences of doing that, and we would like to explore this area later on in this show. Let me just talk about supercomputers real quick. Supercomputers are different from quantum computings, but also quantum computers is one of the main emerging areas right now. We would like to talk about the supercomputers, which, by the way, the fastest computer right now, it keeps skipping Japan to have it one of the supercomputers, Fugaku. These supercomputers can perform a lot of operations. Actually, here is a description about all the specifications. I got this one recently from one of the newsletters. But this computer in particular helped tremendously to fight COVID. I'll talk about that in a little bit. But Fugaku basically performs all the operations in nanoseconds. That's something that we need to be aware of. There's more supercomputers, including quantum computers, that help us to perform trillions of operations per second. And that is something when you really want to solve a real world problem, like a gigantic problem, you need the supercomputers. There's a closest laboratory in Los Alamos when they have a quantum computer and supercomputers close by. And as I mentioned, and there's a couple other ones here. For example, we have NCAR, which is the National Center for Atmospheric Research. That is only devoted for research in atmospheric purposes. But there's a couple of those that I would like to eventually discuss. I was lucky enough to work in a couple of those supercomputing centers, and I would like to talk about that. Now, the Fugaku, what it was actually doing, it was trying to solve this COVID molecules when they were trying to solve what was the best way or in order to get vaccines. They're trying to perform a lot of different, we call it brute force operations, in order to discard which help and which one doesn't. And you need a supercomputer in order to do that. And right now, this supercomputer established in Japan is devoted to do this kind of research, which I think it was amazing, especially because of the time constraints that we have for the past year. A real world scenario that we actually develop here is to calculate the weather here in El Paso. I don't know if you noticed, but in El Paso, we have the Franklin Mountains with a lot of different sensors. Particularly, we have several stations around this area. And what happens is that every minute, they basically, these stations collect a lot of information with different instrumentations. And what happens is that you make averages on these ones. Now, it's not only one temperature. You do pressure, like temperature, atmospheric pressure. So you can make the math here. You have a lot of, you have 19 stations times 7 instruments. That's times 60 minutes. Of course, you can multiply times hours, times days. So this is the number of measurements you have per year. So this is just a lot of data. This is to predict the weather soon to come. If you're interested to calculate the weather in the next 10 years, then you need a lot of information. I will talk about that thing even further later on in different parts, in different shows. So I wanna thank you for your attention in this program. I would like to continue bringing this emerging computing areas in the region, not only here in El Paso, but also in Ciudad Juárez, Las Cruces, everything that has been impacting here, but has impact globally. My name is Cristian Servín, and I would like to see you next time. Meanwhile, have a good one and happy coding. See you next time. Thank you.